Let's talk about another strategy that I often talk to parents about, which is you really have to be careful how to label our child. Do you have this commercial here in Ireland about Life cereal and Mikey? Oh, give it to Mikey. He won't eat it. Have you ever seen that commercial?
I don't have that here.
No? Okay. I love getting your comments, Jennifer, because you're from the States, so you can help me with this.
You're cracking me up with all the American references.
I know.
I'm like, no, he's going to know what it is.
You're like, I know. Well, I'll tell you. This little boy, his name is Mikey, and we have cereal that's very well known, and the tagline is, give it to Mikey. He won't eat it. He's a picky eater. And then they give Mikey the cereal, and he gobbles it up, so obviously we should all buy the cereal. That's the point. Well, the problem with that is we don't want to label kids as picky eaters. If you go to my website, you'll see that on my homepage, I have picky eater all over the homepage. But that's for SEO. That's because parents search under picky eater help to get help, and that's how they can find me and get some resources and articles, etc. I never use that term in front of a child, and I want parents to stop using it immediately. Your child's not a picky eater, he's a learning eater. He's a food explorer. Every child is a learning eater, a food explorer. That's because kids will live up to the label that you give to them. If you label your child a picky eater, he soon sees himself as a picky eater, and he'll live up to that label. It's part of the process of changing the way he thinks about himself. I want kids to come to me and say, I'm really good at broccoli now. Even if the best they can do is take broccoli and maybe dip it in some pudding and paint some pictures with me and make broccoli paintbrushes. You know, that's okay with me too. He's really good at broccoli now. Instead of thinking of himself as, I don't like broccoli, now he likes broccoli. Now he's making friends with broccoli, and eventually we're gonna get to eating broccoli. So if you label them differently, no matter what it is they can do, like, you know, you are the best pea roller in the West because you set up a little marble works or a roller derby and you're rolling peas down it. You know, that's okay. You can crunch that carrot as loud as a T-Rex. Or for my older kids, I might say, you know what? You're becoming an amazing chef. It is so great to be in the kitchen with you. I love it when we taste these new foods and you say to me, I think it needs a little more balsamic. That's brilliant that you figured that out, that sort of thing. Even though the best that kid could do that day is take a tiny taste of something and think about maybe adding something to it so that it suits his palate a little bit better. That's a very different kid than when he first came to me for feeding therapy, so we want to celebrate that. Make them proud of what they can do, and they will try to do even more. So in short, couple simple tips for every family, even if kids aren't in feeding therapy. You want to start with fresh, basic foods first. Always offer very small portions and build from there. Don't forget to offer it over and over and over. We've all heard the research that you have to offer a child new food 12 to 15 times, but it's often misquoted. It's not for a child to like it. It's for a child to accept it. It takes many more than that to learn to love a food. Many, many more. And that particular research is in the very first chapter of Raising Healthy Happy Eater, if you need that reference. Celebrate desired behaviors. Try to ignore the undesired behaviors. They'll quickly fade away. And stay on a schedule. Limit milk and juice. That's so important. It's not about the bite. It's about keeping it fun. And when you keep meal times fun, following the three E's in Veggie Land, expose, explore, expand, kids quickly learn to love new foods.